Hello everyone, thank you for your confidence and for your assistance to our expert talks. This time we will have it about Incoterm, very important aspect when exporting to a client, knowing who is going to handle the custom fees, the insurance, and things like that. We have the opportunity to have a specialist, which is Eddie Verhage. He has worked in the forwarding business for 30 years for Geodis. He has had an office at Recargo, so he's a nice person to give us an overview on the Incoterms. And I let him the floor. Eddie, you may present your knowledge. Or participant, they may shoot their question to the through the question button. Eddie, the floor is yours. So we may go on.
Okay, thanks. Many thanks to Hub Brussels, of course, for the kind invitation. And I appreciate the interest that the participants show in this seminar about Incoterms. So let's get started. I go to the firstly, a little word about the International Chamber of Commerce. That is a non-governmental organization who has the goal to facilitate trade. So, as you see on the slide, it was established 101 years ago in Paris, and they experienced that there were many misunderstandings at that time with regard to sales and delivery arrangements and agreements. There was no global system available at that time. So, in order to avoid disputes and discrepancies in the interpretation of trade terms, the International Chamber of Commerce decided to create universal and codified standard rules, the Incoterms. The word Incoterms is derived from international commercial terms. The first set was created in 1936, and since 1980, there is a revision every 10 years in order to adapt to the ever-changing rules of practices. So we can say that ICC has over 100 years experience with a study of the evolving commercial transactions. I can give you a full definition about Incoterms. Incoterms are standard rules that stipulate the dividing of cost, tasks, and transfer of risk between a seller and a buyer in accordance with the obligation to deliver movable merchandise within the context of both domestic and international sales. But now, with the next following slides, I will analyze these five aspects. So I start with standard rules. One moment. Yeah, standard rules. In the actual version, ICC offers the merchants the possibility to choose between 11 standard models. And I show here the 11 acronyms. It are always three-letter acronyms, as you see. And they are here enumerated in an order from the least cost for account of the seller, that is ex works, up to the most costs for account of the seller, that is DDP. Of course, later on this afternoon, we will focus on each and every Incoterm. But let's go on with the analysis of the definition. Next slide. Yes, also a little word about further word about standard rules. So standard rules are agreements between seller and buyer interpreted in an identical way by both parties. So we can surely say that the package of the 11 Incoterm rules is the only global standard that meets such criteria, the only worldwide standard. However, Incoterm rules are no mandatory law. So if there is a local government who writes down very specific provisions, then they prevail over Incoterm. Anyway, it is strongly recommended that the selected Incoterm rule should always be mentioned in the four following documents: the sales offer that is issued by the seller, then the purchase order confirmation issued by the buyer, the sales contract signed by both parties, and the commercial invoice issued by the seller. So, very important, when you work with Incoterm, please mention the Incoterm on these four documents. We continue with the analysis of the definition. The dividing of task, cost, and transfer of risk. Tasks, for example, who must take care for the custom formalities, who must take out the cargo insurance, then dividing of cost, who must pay what kind of handling cost, for example, and who has to take the freight cost for his account and starting from which particular point. Transfer of risk, what is the critical point in the scope of the supply of merchandise and who is liable in case of damage or loss. So all of these aspects are included in one particular acronym, in one particular Incoterm.
Eddie, before we go further, yeah. you said that some countries may impose different conditions than the Incoterm.
That's right.
Are there known countries that don't use Incoterm or
no?
No.
As I will explain further on the following slides, you will see on one slide that I have mentioned that UNCITRAL, that is the United Nations, that is the division of the United Nations, that they strongly recommend to use Incoterm. So, as we all know, nearly each country of the world is member of the United Nations. There are only a few exceptions like Taiwan, but that is only a political question because of the struggle with China, the People's Republic. But for the rest, nearly all countries in the world are member of the United Nations. So that means that every country is tolerating the use of Incoterm.
Okay.
Yeah. What I mean
specific particular
legislative provisions that are made out or written by some governments.
Yeah.
I can give you a good example here in the port of Antwerp. I'm living at Antwerp here.
Mm-hmm.
They consider the transfer of risk and cost otherwise than with the Incoterm. But I will explain that when we arrive to pre on board later on. Okay.
Okay, so
okay.
Let's go on. Thank you.
Okay, so now we continue with the analysis of the definition. I have said it is between seller and buyer, so that are the two merchants, as I say in English, eh? Merchants. Pay attention, ladies and gentlemen, it is always within a business-to-business context. So, Incoterms do not deal with business-to-consumer context. So that means with the spectacular rise of e-commerce, where particular persons who don't have a company and who order goods from another country, for example, the United States, normally such e-commerce send out to particular people are not treated by Incoterms. So normally the basic principle is Incoterms is within B2B context. That is why I say that the seller is in general a manufacturer or a trader or a public authority. And the buyer is either a material purchaser of the goods or a trader or a public authority. Okay.
For B2C relation, yeah. Companies yeah. have to define in the general condition how yeah. they deal with foreign
yeah.
foreign particular customer.
That is right.
Okay.
That is right. With B2C, the seller should stipulate carefully all the conditions of delivery. Eh?
Okay.
But we know all. For example, when we import, let's say, some small auto parts
yeah.
from the United States, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
And I am a particular person without company, mm-hmm. then when this small box of auto parts arrive at Brussels airport,
yeah.
then the Belgian customs will automatically start a procedure of import duties.
Yeah.
So my opinion, and the opinion of many specialists about Incoterms, it could be possible that with the next revision in 2030, that ICC will be forced to consider the e-commerce as well,
okay.
because it is so spectacularly growing. You see?
Okay.
All right. So we go on with the analysis of the definition. I've said with the obligation to deliver movable merchandise. So the seller must always deliver the goods that are subject to commercial transaction, but it shall be movable merchandise. So that means it is not applicable for example, the sale of electronic data. I give you an example. When a music company is sending a big, what is the name in English? A big quantity of music electronically to a company in another country, then this sale is not possible with Incoterms for the simple reason that there is no physical transport, you see? When you sell electronic data, there is no physical transport. Eh?
Okay.
So Incoterms are applicable for movable goods. Goods there who are physically movable. See, That's the
Okay.
main principle. Okay, we go on with the analysis. Within the context of both domestic and international sales, we have seen in the first two slides that the initial purpose of ICC was to facilitate the international commerce, but over the years, Incoterms have become available for domestic sales contracts as well. And that is interesting. For example, in one custom union like the EU, where you can sell from Belgium to Germany, for example, but also in the USA, where normally and historically in the USA, they had their own uniform commercial codes. And they have been very popular, more than the Incoterms, but since there were revisions in the US Uniform Commercial Code, there is started opposition in many states of the United States. So in order to avoid the new confusion that was growing since 2004, the USA market experienced that Incoterms have a practical convenience within the framework of a domestic transaction. More practical, it became more practical than their own US Uniform Commercial Code. So that means, to give an example, a seller in New York, he could easily use Incoterms to sell his goods to someone in California. You see? So that is really a domestic sale, and Incoterms can be used for such domestic sale as well. Okay, we go on. Yeah, that was the final analysis of the definition. Huh? Now, interesting for the ladies and gentlemen who are participating this session, why is it recommended to use the Incoterms? As I said, because they are in the first place universal trade terms, merchants all over the world should understand the meaning of the acronyms. By reading and agreeing such acronym, both seller and buyer should know automatically who will arrange the transport, who will bear the risk, who will have to carry out custom formalities, who will have to go to conclude an insurance. So by applying the ICC Incoterms, the merchants don't need anymore to elaborate on the above mentioned conditions in their transactions, because such conditions are integrated, are already part of the used acronym itself. And a very interesting aspect is also that not only merchants are familiar with acronyms, Incoterms acronyms, but also forwarders, custom brokers, lawyers, bankers, carriers, and custom authorities. I give you this example. When a merchant who is applying the Incoterms do their business with the assistance of a forwarder, then this forwarder will immediately recognize what the chosen Incoterms rule implies.
Mm-hmm.
So in principle, this forwarder will be able to give a price offer that is tailor-made according to the acronym indicated by its client. You see?
Okay.
Okay, we go on. Still, a transaction can be agreed without using Incoterms. As mentioned in my slide number 5, the Incoterms are non-mandatory law. This has an advantage for ICC because the fact that there is no fixed law makes ICC see that they have the advantage of flexibility, because the changing market practices can lead to adjusted or even new Incoterms rules without imposing the country's governments to adapt each time their legislation. You understand? If every country in the world each time has to adapt the renewed Incoterms in their rules, then there is a big lot of work to do for each country. So at this moment, no country of the world is implementing Incoterms in its law. I have understood that for a while it has been the case in Ukraine some decades ago, but that is changed now also. Anyway, the use of Incoterms is encouraged by UNCITRAL, that is the United Nations Commission of International Trade Law. Now, given that Incoterms are no legislative obligation, the merchants are still free to issue transactions without using the Incoterms rules, but pay attention, by not using the Incoterms rules, the merchants will have to be very careful with the stipulation of a whole lot of particular conditions. Any sales contract that would not adequately be drafted provokes disputes. You see? We must pay attention to the fact that Incoterms do not deal with a number of matters. In the first place, they do not impose the merchant to make a contract of sale. Making a contract of sale is no obligation at all. Anyway, if such contract of sale is existing, then the Incoterms do not regulate the duration of that contract or the termination, nor the remedies in case of contract breach. Incoterms do not deal with force majeure. So I can give the advice to the merchants when they make up a sales contract that they include a force majeure clause.
Yeah, it's quite important for the moment with the COVID crisis to have this force majeure and hardship.
For sure, especially in the beginning of the crisis of the pandemic 1 year ago, then it was very, very important that the force majeure clause was included, because at that time there were, for example, ships that were held in the port of destination, and then there were waiting times. And then there was the dispute, who will pay the waiting times? But now, 1 year later, the pandemic is still going on, but you can not start with saying now that there is a force majeure, because you know that since 1 year, this pandemic is going on. But as I repeat, last year in the month of February, March, it was very important that such clause should exist in the contract with regard to this virus, of course. But in general, it is always a good advice to use to implement a force majeure hardship clause in your sales contract. And I know that the International Chamber of Commerce, they have a sort of example that you can use freely and implement in your text.
In your sales contract, you may.
Out of International Chamber of Commerce.
Okay.
Next point is also very important. The Incoterms that do not deal with the transfer of ownership. So please, ladies and gentlemen, participants, please mention when the transfer of ownership is going on. You can, for example, mention that the ownership is transferred on the moment of delivery. And the technical word of delivery, I will explain you later on with the coming slides. Also very important, payment conditions with regard to sold goods are not is not a concern of Incoterm rules. So again, you have to stipulate your payment conditions very clearly on your sales contract. For example, 30 days, sorry, after after delivery. Also important, the revenue recognition. So for the chief accountant of your office, when you are a seller, then the chief accountant should determine when he can firmly book the sale. And normally, usually the revenue will be recognized at the moment of risk transfer.
Okay.
Okay. Then also applicable law in competent court are not dealt with Incoterms, so that again you have to stipulate on your contract.
Okay.
And then lastly, the Incoterms do not deal with import or export prohibitions or with intellectual property rights. All right, we go on. Since the 1st of January from last year, there are 11 different Incoterm rules, and 7 of them are applicable for any mode of transport: ex-works, free carrier, carriage pay to, carriage insurance paid, delivered at place unloaded, and delivery duty paid. And then there are 4 Incoterm rules that are applicable for sea and inland waterway transport, that is free alongside ship, free on board, cost and freight, and cost insurance freight. Of course, we will analyze all of this in the next slides. Huh? Pay attention when you use variation on these Incoterm rules. Variations are allowed, but have to be considered carefully and agreed between the both merchants. Okay. So we start now with a presentation of the 11 existing Incoterms rules. And the first is ex-works, acronym EXW, followed by an agreed place of departure. And I give you an example. Let's say that you, as a seller, you have a head office at Brussels, and your goods are available for taking delivery in your warehouse at Namur. The buyer, he is living at Cologne in Germany. In an ex-works transaction, then it will become ex-works Namur, Incoterms 2020. And I go on with some notes about ex-works. Ex-works are applicable for any mode of transport. The seller has to make available the goods at a named place, in general, his own premises, so in this case at Namur, and the risks are transferred as soon as the seller has clearly informed the buyer that the goods are available for taking delivery. So just a simple message from the seller is the point where the risk will be transferred to the buyer. So that means when the buyer waits 2 weeks after the message to come to get the merchandise, then the risk of damage during these 2 weeks are already for the buyer, you see?
Okay, so it's the easiest Incoterm for companies that begin to export, saying I sell X work, so yeah, all the paperwork, all the risks, a great part of the risk is taken by the buyer and not by the seller.
I get the message. Webcam closed by organizer. The organizer has stopped sharing the webcam.
This is someone.
Okay.
We'll get it back.
Yes, Laurent.
Normally you will come back, Eddie, but we still hear you, which is
Okay. Maybe someone
has better with your face on the screen, but we'll try to. I don't know what's happening, in fact.
I see. I always the slide before me. You see the slides?
Well, we all see the slides, so it's not a problem.
Okay, we go on. So
normally we will see your camera back. You should receive a message to have your camera, but we still see your slide,
and we still
hear you, so we can go on.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So Laurent, yes, that's a nice remark from you. The buyer, he bears all the risk in the cost, including loading at the seller premises.
Okay. So we can move to next slide.
Important. Yeah. Even the export formalities are for account of the buyer. Of course, in this example, from Namur to Cologne, it is the same custom union, from Belgium to Germany. So there are no export formalities. And And that is why I give this advice. Ex-works can only be used in case of inland or intra-community transaction. I know that Ex-works is very popular, but I must say the fact that the buyer should have to load the goods by himself is already posing some problems, because more and more the buyers or the driver of the buyer is forbidden to enter the warehouse of the seller, right?
So due to COVID reasons,
it's much more appropriate to use free carrier, and that is the next slide that I like to show.
Nice. So we move to the next one.
So the next slide will be FCA, free carrier. But there we have two options. We have, in the first place, we have free carrier seller's premises. And again, I work with examples.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say that the seller's premises are at Anderlecht. The goods, in this case, they have a big quantity, 250 cases with tools. So with this big quantity, it is appropriate to load in a container. So the cases will be stuffed by the seller into a 20-foot container. So that means full container load. Let's say that the buyer is at Beirut.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now with this free carrier seller's premises option, the buyer will arrange and pay the whole carriage of the container from Anderlecht to Beirut. So that means the pre-Indian charge in Belgium and the ocean freight and the own carriage in Lebanon are all for account of the buyer. The transaction will be FCA Anderlecht.
Okay.
But the big advantage compared with Ex-works is that the buyer doesn't have to load the goods at Anderlecht. The goods will be loaded in the container by the seller. You see, that is the main advantage compared with Ex-works. And another big advantage is that the buyer will not have to make export formalities in Belgium.
Okay.
In that the case in Xworks, huh?
Okay.
Therefore, when we should have Xworks with a buyer who lives at Lebanon, then mm-hmm. this buyer should make export formalities in Belgium. That
yeah.
is quite difficult.
Okay.
Okay. We
but
go on.
The Belgian exporter has always to prove that the goods have left Belgium, because
yes.
otherwise he will have issues with the Belgian VAT if he cannot prove.
That's right. The proof is that the Belgian exporter who has made his export document under
yeah.
FCR Incoterms,
mm-hmm.
his export document proves that the goods are leaving the European Union, so
okay.
he has not to take care about VAT.
Okay.
Yeah. Then I go on with the
yeah.
second, with the second option of free carrier. The second option is free carrier elsewhere. And we go on with the same example, a seller at Anderlecht and a buyer at Beirut. But in this case, I tell you about only 20 cases with tools. So 20 cases is appropriate to go to Lebanon with an airplane. So what happens here? The seller will deliver the goods at Brucargo, Brussels Airport. And then the buyer bears all the risk and cost as from the discharging of the goods at the cargo handler's warehouse at Brucargo. So the buyer arranges and pays also the air freight, of course. So very concrete, the seller, he has to deliver at Brucargo, but the discharging of his 20 cases is not for his account. The discharging is already for account of the buyer, and all the further aspects like brouettage vers l'avion, the air freight, and also all the further things are for account of the buyer. Eh? In this case, the transaction will be FCA, Brucargo, Brussels Airport. And I give you some further notes. FCA is applicable for any mode of transport. Risk and costs are borne by the seller. In case of the first option, seller's premises, then the seller, he pays all the costs up to and including the loading on the carrier nominated by the buyer. So in our example, the seller pays up to and including the stuffing of the container. Eh? And then in case of the second option, FCA elsewhere, then the seller, pays every cost until the goods are put at the disposal of the buyer in the agreed place of delivery, ready for unloading. And this agreed place of delivery is Brucargo at Zaventem. Export formalities is very logical. It's for the seller, and import formalities in Lebanon is for the buyer. All right, we go on. Carriage paid two. So that is the third of 11 Incoterms. Yeah? Again, with an example. And I must tell the audience that this A4 schedule is a graphic presentation that you could compare with all my texts, and Hub Brussels will be glad to give you a link where you can obtain this A4, because it is a formal and official publication of the International Chamber of Commerce. Normally, the International Chamber of Commerce their products and publications are quite expensive, but this one is totally free. So you can download it freely on a link that will be provided by Hub Brussels. Unfortunately, I could not integrate this graphic on my PowerPoint presentation slides because it should be too small, you see?
Yeah.
Anyway,
as you said, Eddie, we will send the A4 graphic with all the Incoterms to the participant after the seminar.
Fine. Fine. Very good. Okay. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, let's use your imagination when I talk about different cities and different ports. Now, I give you an example about a warehouse at Thune, Province de Hainaut. So, in this example, carriage pay 2, the seller is living at Thune, and he brings his goods to the port of Zeebrugge. What is, geographically speaking, is quite a logic combination. But then from Zeebrugge, the goods will go to Santos, which is an important harbor in Brazil. But the buyer himself, he lives at Sao Paulo in the metropole. In case of carriage pay 2, the cost aspect is as follows. The seller pays all the costs up to arrival at Sao Paulo, not discharged. But the risk, however, they are being transferred in an earlier stage because the seller bears the risks up to loading on the carrier in the exporting country. So as from departure already, the buyer bears the risk. In this case, in this example, this means that the buyer bears already the risks as from departure in Thune. The transaction will be CPT Sao Paulo. And I'll give you some further explanation. CPT is applicable for any mode of transport. The risks are borne by the seller up to and including the loading on the first carrier. That's why I say at Thune, the risk is already transferred in our example. But the costs are borne by the seller all the way to Sao Paulo, ready for unloading. So the unloading at Sao Paulo is for the buyer. Now I give you this small advice about the place of delivery, because ladies and gentlemen, you should know that place of delivery, technically spoken, means for Incoterms, the place of risk transfer. And ICC is strongly advising to indicate in the sale contract not only the point of destination, in this case CPT Sao Paulo, but also to stipulate the place of delivery, in this case that is Thune. And why is this advice? Because this allows the buyer to know if he is interested to take a cargo insurance, then the buyer knows that he should take the cargo insurance as from Thune and not from, for example, from Zeebrugge. Okay.
When you speak about cargo insurance, how is the fee that the buyer in this case will have to pay to his insurance company calculated? It depends on the product that will be transported, the value, the risk
depends
that are covered.
On the product, that's right. But in general, for general cargo, let's say, when you pay 0.35% on the value,
all the value,
average premium.
There's the average premium for sending something everywhere in the world.
Yeah, for general cargo, huh?
Okay, for
as
general
cargo. As you said, it depends about particularity of goods, but for general cargo, with 0.30 or 0.35% on the value, you have average premium. It is so expensive, and you avoid a lot of problems.
And it covers.
I will talk about that.
Okay.
Later when I speak about the two Incoterms where cargo insurance is mandatory.
Okay.
Just later on. Here with CPT, it is not mandatory.
Okay.
Okay. And then this last information, this last note, the final place of receipt in the importing country does not necessarily have to be an inland point. In our example, the agreement could also have been the seaport of Santos. In that case, the transaction would have been CPT Santos. You see, that is allowed by Incoterms. Eh? You don't have to be mentioning the final place of receipt. It can also be a seaport, eh? A destination. Eh? All right. The next is one of the two Incoterm rules with a mandatory insurance. Carrier and insurance paid to is the very same as the former slide as the CPT. There is just one additional obligation. CIP imposes the seller to arrange a contract of insurance at their own cost to cover the buyer's risk during the transport. And this insurance cover will comply with the, that's a technical term, the Institute Cargo Clauses A. That means all the risks are covered according to the famous English policy. But also similar conditions provided by other reputed insurance are also allowed. Anyway, what is for sure, the amount of the insurance must be at least 100% of the value mentioned in the sales contract. You see, talking about this cargo insurance, why is it so important to take one? I just say there are only two of the 11 Incoterm rules where it is mandatory, but also for the all other remaining Incoterms, it is nevertheless very recommended to take an insurance because, as I just said, the premium is not so expensive. And what is very important, you avoid financial tragedies when, for example, a ship is declaring general average. Then the principle of general average says that the goods who are saved will contribute to the goods who are lost. So imagine for a while that you as a seller or a merchant are the only one which goods have been saved and all the rest is gone, then you have to contribute for all the others. So when you are insured, then this risk is always covered, always.
Okay, so the insurance, it covers the loss of the product, the destruction of the product, the damage to the product, or?
Yeah, with Institute Cargo Clauses A, all the risks are covered. So indeed,
all the risks are covered.
Loss and theft and damage and general average are all covered. by the insurer.
Okay.
Okay. Why do they say 100% of the value? That is because the buyer, on his turn, when he receives damaged goods,
yeah,
he will not be able to take some benefits when he sells further on his goods. Huh? Therefore, mm-hmm, this imaginable profit that he's losing is also covered by this additional 10%.
Okay.
The main,
that's why.
Okay.
So practically, when applying for an insurance, you have your container that is ready to leave the company,
yeah,
and then you ask at this moment you ask the insurance, and
yeah,
it's quite and you receive it within the minutes or
yeah, with the actual technical advantages, the
yeah,
insurance companies or even the forwarders who have good connections with the insurers, they
yes,
can make ready an insurance in a few minutes. They have to,
okay,
to tap some elements on
a computer,
on a formula, and
yeah,
it's ready. No, that
okay,
is very, very
that's
convenient.
Very fast. Okay.
It's very convenient, yes. Of course, you have to insure before the goods leave. Eh?
Okay.
Okay. So in this case, ladies and gentlemen, the transaction will be CIP Sao Paulo, which is quite the same as CPT plus the cargo insurance for the transport up to Sao Paulo to be taken out by the seller. All right. Then we continue. Delivered at place. So again, maybe I hope that you can use your imagination, because now I go to Liège, a seller who is ready to load a big quantity of tools, say 250 cases, in his warehouse at Liège, and he's taking a truck. This time, a truck doesn't necessarily have to be ships all the time. We can also work with trucks. So a truck to Paris. Very simple. The seller pays all the costs up to arrival at Paris, not discharged. So the transaction will be DAP Paris. And I give you some notes again. DAP is applicable for any mode of transport. That is why I've taken the example of a truck delivery. The risk and the costs are borne by the seller up to arrival on board of the truck at the agreed point of destination, ready for unloading by the buyer. And export and import formalities is quite logical. Export is for the seller, import is for the buyer. In this case, of course, there are no custom formalities because it is a transaction between Belgium and France. Huh? So that is very simple. We can easily go to the next.
Yeah, I have a question about EAP. Someone is asking the question that this follows. The suppliers has written his invoice with the price of the goods and the logistics costs, the transportation costs.
Yeah.
And he says that in this case, the custom tax will apply to the whole amount, the goods and the transportation.
Yeah, but is it talking about intra?
No, in this case, it's not. It we consider an export outside European Union. The supplier invoices the goods and the transport fee as a whole, and then he says here, then in this case, the custom fee will apply to the whole amount without distinguishing the custom cost on the goods and the transport cost, which are not subjected to custom taxation. Is it correct? Yes,
but we have to make a distinction for the seller. Yeah. When he makes his commercial invoice, DAP, then he has right that he mentions on the invoice the value of the goods and the transport. That is quite right. But for the importer outside the European Union, there the custom duties in the and any VAT in some countries, because not every country of the world is using VAT, but Anyway, the import duties will be calculated on a custom value. And
on the custom value, okay.
For example, when in the United States or in Canada, the custom value will be FOB. So in that case, when a Canadian custom officer, he gets a commercial invoice with DAP Montreal, then the custom broker at Canada, he will have to calculate on his
on the total on the
import declaration, he will have to calculate and go back to a FOB value, you see, and then on that FOB value the duties in Canada will be calculated. The duties on the VAT will be calculated on the FOB value.
On the FOB value. So the import duties will be calculated on the goods and the transportation cost.
Yeah. I give you another example, Laurent. When you are importing in the European Union from another country, for example, from Australia.
Yeah.
And if the Australian seller, he has made an invoice DAP Brussels, then the Belgian custom broker will have to calculate and go back to a CIF value, because in the European Union, the custom value, so the duties in the VAT, are calculated based on a CIF value. So you see, when you get as a buyer, as a purchaser of goods in Belgium, you will get a DAP invoice from Australia, then the custom broker will have to calculate and go back to value CIF.
All
right. Then the next slide is delivered at place unloaded, DPU. So again, we are talking here about this seller at Liège, but in this case, he has only 20 cases of tools, so a small quantity. And again, his buyer is living at Paris, but the buyer at Paris, he wants to receive the goods at the deconsolidation warehouse at Valenciennes. That's on the way to Paris. So in case of DPU, the seller pays all the costs up to arrival at Valenciennes, discharging of the goods included. So the transaction will be here, DPU Valenciennes, Incoterms 2020. And I give you again some notes about this. DPU is applicable for any mode of transport. That is why I show here the example of a truck. The risk and cost are borne by the seller up to arrival at the agreed point of destination in Valenciennes, unloaded by the seller. So the seller has to make an order to an instruction to the Valenciennes warehouse to discharge the goods for his account. What is the big advantage of DPU? It is very appropriate in case of delivery of the goods in a deconsolidation hub on their way between seller and buyer's premises. Okay. Because in this example, the Paris purchaser may be On this term, he has many buyers in the northern part of France. So when he instructs the seller to go not further than Valenciennes, then from there on, when the goods are placed by the seller in that warehouse, from there on, the buyer at Paris can distribute, in this turn, the goods to all the buyers in northern France, you see? That's the advantage, huh? Anyway,
okay.
The final delivery at buyer's own premises is also permitted. So with DPU, and that is now a new rule with Incoterms 2020, with DPU, you can also deliver at Paris, discharged by the seller. And why they have added this option? Because sometimes it happens that for the installation of particular goods, it is necessary that the seller himself, he installs the goods at the buyer's house, right? And therefore, of course, the seller has to discharge the goods from the truck also, right? You see, but the main reason was for DPU was to deliver goods on the way to the final destination. You get the picture? Okay, now we go on with the next point. Delivered duty paid. The seller, he is living at Mons, and the buyer is living at Beograd, Belgrade in Serbia. Here I have taken the example of a main transport by train. So what is happening here? The seller is bringing the goods to the station at Mons. Then the train goes all the way to Serbia. And further on, the seller will have to arrange the on carriage to the buyer's premises at Belgrade City. The very important aspect is the custom formalities, because the seller with DDP is obliged to establish all sort of custom formalities, including the import custom formalities in Serbia. So here the transaction will be DDP Belgrade. I have, okay, of course, some notes about DDP applicable for any mode of transport. That is why I have chosen here the example of main rail transport. The cost and the risk are borne by the seller up to arrival on board of the carrier at the agreed point of destination, ready for unloading by the buyer. Export and import is for the seller risk and cost. So normally, I should say that DDP is not advisable to work with, because the seller may encounter practical difficulties for the custom import clearance in a country where the seller is not familiar to work with customs. Eh? So in general, we should say that DAP is to be preferred above DDP, because DAP is quite the same, except for this import formalities. Eh? With DAP, mm-hmm, the import formalities are for the buyer, which is quite logical.
Yeah.
I must say, the drafting group of Incoterms has considered the possibility back in a few years ago when they prepared the 2020 version. They have considered the possibility to stop with DDP. But finally, DDP was maintained. It's a little bit the same problem with X-Works. Eh? That are the two extreme,
yeah,
aspects of Incoterms, where there is no logic about custom formalities, but the philosophy of ICC drafting group was, after all, they said, okay, let's maintain XWorks, because XWorks is in fact a catalog price, not more than that, just a catalog price,
Mm-hmm.
And then DDP is in fact all in price.
Mm.
And I must say, some multinationals, they can use DDP because they have branches, like here in this example, maybe a multinational has a good branch in Beograd, and then they could work with DDP. And then they could mention the seller in Mons as being a buyer in Beograd because of the advantages of good branches where they can use VAT number locally. But normally for starters, I would disadvise to use DDP.
Okay.
All right.
All right, yeah.
Okay, right. Ladies and gentlemen, then we go to the four remaining Incoterms, and that are meant only for waterway transport. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Free alongside ship, that is the first of four remaining Incoterm rules that are used for waterway transport only. So this time the seller is living at Charleroi and he's taking a barge. And you know, the canal Charleroi, Brussels, and then Brussels, Antwerp. So the barge go all the way to Antwerp. And there is a ship ready for loading, a ship who has been reserved by the buyer. The buyer is, in this case, is living at Vancouver with free alongside ship. The buyer pays all the cost as from loading the goods in the sea ship at Antwerp. You see? So the seller, he pays the trajectory on the canal between Charleroi and Antwerp.
Yeah.
And then the buyer, he pays everything as from the loading on that sea ship at Antwerp port. Eh? So in this case, the transaction will be FES Antwerp. And I talk here about brick bulk quay because free alongside ship is appropriate for brick bulk goods, not for containers.
Okay.
Okay, I go to the slide with some notes about FES. One moment. Eh? Yeah, so FES is applicable for sea or inland waterway transport. The use of FES is appropriate for non-containerized goods and or bulk cargo. Risk and costs are borne by the seller up to arrival of the carrier at the agreed point of delivery, is the port of loading, where the goods will be put alongside the vessel nominated by the buyer. So taking the goods on board of the vessel is at buyer's risk and cost. You could use FES also for inland waterway. If you in Charleroi have a client at, let's say, at Brussels, then this is a domestic sale. Then you could FES also, provided that the seller, provided that the buyer in Brussels, he should place a barge at Charleroi. And then the transport from the barge from Charleroi to Brussels is for account of the buyer. And the Incoterm will be FES Charleroi. You see, that is a domestic trade transaction where you can use FES because you use waterway transport. I must say, EVS is not so popular. On the other side, free on board is very popular. It will be free on board. So again, we have the same merchants, the seller at Charleroi and the buyer at Vancouver, eh? The same merchants. So I speak here about conventional cargo, because that is very appropriate to go with free on board. The seller's conventional cargo leave the warehouse at Charleroi on a truck this time, on a truck. And the seller delivers with a truck the goods to the port of Antwerp and loads the goods on a vessel nominated by the buyer. So the Canadian buyer, he again will nominate a sea ship. The buyer pays all the costs as from the sea freight price, Antwerp, Vancouver. And the transaction will be FOB Antwerp, conventional cargo carrier, Incoterms 2020. We all know that free on board is used, is very popular, eh? Very, very popular, because it's a term that is dating from more than 100 years ago, even before Incoterms was invented. It was already used in the United Kingdom. So free on board is very, very popular, but is misused. For example, they use it very often for air transport, and it is not appropriate for air transport, only for water transport. So if you have air transport, you could easily go to FCA instead of free on board, because FCA, free carrier, as we have seen, is for any kind of transport possible. Yeah? Free on board is only for waterway transport. Anyway, if there is a commercial invoice for an air traffic, which is saying it would be Brussels, it is not forbidden, eh? It is not forbidden, but it provokes disputes, because the term FOB was not invented for air freight, only for waterway transport. You see? Okay, a few words about FOB, one moment. Yeah, so FOB applicable for sea or waterway, appropriate for non-containerized goods, because if you have containers, then you should choose for FCA also, not for FOB. So if you have containers to be sent, use FCA instead of FOB. The risk and costs are borne by the seller up to arrival of the seller's carrier at the agreed point of delivery, which is the port of loading, where the goods will be loaded at the seller's risks and cost. Export and import formalities are quite logical, but then we have on the bottom of this slide, we have this remark, the usages of the port prevail over Incoterms rules. And that is why, Laurent, you mentioned in the beginning of the session, the aspect of legal written recommendations. Yes, they always prevail over Incoterms. And I must say, the Port of Antwerp is a good example. They say with FOB that the risk is already for the buyer, when the goods are tightened up on the, how is it in English? On the crane to get the goods on board. So that is an earlier stage than what the Incoterm rule says. The Incoterm rules say that the risk is transferring when the goods are already loaded in the ship.
Okay.
Port of Antwerp, they say no, the risk is already transferred when the goods are tightened up at the crane who is going to
lift the goods
to the ship, you see.
Okay.
Yeah, that is so that is always prevailing over Incoterms.
Okay.
All right, then the two last Incoterm rules are cost in freight and cost in term freight. So firstly, cost in freight, the seller good are leaving at Brussels, on a carrier nominated by the seller. Port of loading is Rotterdam. Port of discharge is Sydney. The buyer is living at Canberra, which is the capital of Australia. Here, the cost aspect is as follows. The seller pays all the cost up to arrival at the port of Sydney, the port, not discharge. And the risk, the seller bears the risk up to loading on the sea ship at the port of sailing only, so at the port of Rotterdam. And here the transaction will be cost in freight Sydney. Again, some notes. Applicable for sea and waterway transport only. The use of CFR is appropriate for non-containerized goods. So if you have goods in containers, you should not use CFR, but CPT. Carrier pay two, because carrier pay two is much more logical about the transfer of risk and cost. With cost and freight, the risk and the costs are transferred not at the same moment. The risk, okay, namely, they are borne by the seller up to and including the loading on the sea ship, while the costs are borne by the seller up to arriving in Sydney port, ready for unloading by the buyer. And then the last one, cost insurance freight, is the very same as cost and freight, but there is one additional obligation, that is that the seller would subscribe an insurance at their own cost to cover the buyer's risk during the sea voyage. And this insurance, this cargo insurance, which will comply with Institute Cargo Clauses C, not as we have seen with CIP. There we have said that it is Institute Cargo Clauses A. Here it is only C, and that means limited risk covered. And this limited risk, that means that, for example, theft is not included, is not covered. The very important aspect of general average is covered, nevertheless. And that is very important. As I explained earlier this afternoon, the general average is always covered, also with the C clauses. All the other rules are the same as with CFR. So in this transaction, it will be CIF Sydney Incoterms 2020. And it is quite the same as CPT plus the cargo insurance. Okay. Things to keep in mind, ladies and gentlemen, things to keep in mind. You have to be as detailed as possible when you choose an acronym. You take the chosen acronym, but this has to be followed by a name place as detailed as possible. You're followed by Incoterms 2020. And I give this example, FCA Brussels, Trimodal Terminal Quai Lyon-Monnoyer, Incoterms 2020. So please be as detailed as possible, because with FCA Brussels, the foreign buyer will have to come with his carrier to Brussels. So when you add Trimodal Terminal Quai Lyon-Monnoyer, then there is no confusion possible, then the buyer knows that he has to go there and not to Brussels center, for example. Now, you have to add Incoterms 2020 also, because if you don't add Incoterms 2020 to the chosen acronym, then you will have to describe your own interpretation of meaning of CFCA. If you don't add Incoterms 2020, the ICC rules will not be applicable, with dangers for disputes as a possible consequence. Very important, huh? So use an acronym, detail the address, and add the word Incoterms 2020. All right, then a very important thing to keep in mind, as I said already, the place of delivery is the place where the risk transfers from buyer to from seller to buyer. So in the above example, the place of delivery is Brussels, and Brussels at the trimodal terminal. And I have spoken about the recognition the thing that the chief accountant should book firmly his invoice. Eh? Mm-hmm. So in most cases, the recognition will be made at the moment of risk transfer.
Okay.
So in this case, with FCA Brussels, the bookkeeper can book his invoice at the moment that the goods are delivered at Brussels trimodal terminal. That is a habitude that is made by many chief accountants.
So the payment delay starts from the risks of when the transfer of property takes place.
No, but you have to watch out. You have the transfer of property, but you have also I have to search for the English word. One moment, I go back to the other slides. One moment. One moment. Revenue. Yeah. So, okay, let's be clear. You have revenue, and with FCA Brussels trimodal terminal, the chief accountant can. One moment, I go back to where I was. Yeah. Yeah. The chief accountant can book the revenue recognition at the moment of risk transfer. In this case, it is when the goods are delivered at Brussels trimodal terminal. And as you say, Laurent, with the aspect of transfer of property, you could indeed consider the same moment, but it is not obligatory. Eh?
You but can not,
you have free choice to choose the moment of transfer of property. Eh? Many sellers will say transfer of property will only be when the goods are paid. You see,
okay. So
that's another aspect. Eh? We have to make a distinction between the revenue recognition and the aspect of transport of property. Eh?
Okay.
And then the last thing that I have mentioned here on this slide, things to keep in mind, the C rules are the only whereby the risks are transferred at an earlier stage in comparison with the moment of cost transfer. Eh? So CPT, CIP, CFR, CIF, there the rules, the risks are transferred in an earlier stage than the cost. Okay. Then we have some remaining slides where I had a word about which of the 11 rules is preferable for sellers, but I don't know, Laurent, if we have still the time to go through this.
It's quite tight regarding time, so I propose I have some questions, and we'll shoot the questions, and we will send your slides like PDF to every attendant to this seminar.
Okay. Because the remaining slides are not essential, they are good for additional information, so the participant can read that when you send the slides. All right. Okay.
Nice. There was a question regarding service contracts. You said there are no Incoterms on services. It applies only to goods. So I think you answer this question in your speech. I have another question. If the shipping companies like FedEx, UPS manage, do they help the exporter in the choice of the Incoterm they would have to use? Do companies like FedEx and UPS give advice to exporters?
No. Such courier companies, no, they don't give firmly advice, in my opinion. But as we talked earlier about e-commerce, I have heard that an important American exporter, I think it's Amazon, but I'm not sure, that they are starting with showing on their formula to the purchaser the possibility if the duties would be already paid by the seller. So there is something moving in this business, and that is why I say that maybe with the next version of Incoterms in 2030, the International Chamber of Commerce will consider the growing and the exploding business of e-commerce to integrate that in the rules. But no, I'm afraid that companies like UPS, they don't advise the clients about Incoterms.
You have been in the business of a forwarding agent. The forwarding agent, what does it does in the process of in the logistic and the custom process, in the delivery process? What is his role?
I strongly advise to the merchants to always work together with the forwarder, because the forwarder, they are used to treat all these aspects as custom formalities, things like cargo insurances, things like some certificates that should be obliged by some authorities. That's their job, and that's their knowledge.
Okay.
So to the ladies and gentlemen, I always advise, please do not go straight to a carrier, but contact the forwarder.
I understood that a forwarding agent was not so expensive. So to have,
that's right.
Depends on the the amount of product that you will have to transport, but it's around 50 euro, I think, for having the paperwork done. Is it right?
It is actually a little bit more, but the initial task of a forwarder, normalement en français on dit commissionnaire au transport, commissionnaire.
Okay.
So that means he pays cost to a carrier, and it takes only a little commission on that.
Okay.
And that commission, that will be then invoiced to the merchant. Eh?
Okay.
But indeed, the forwarders are not so expensive. Of course, they have many paperwork to do, or digital paperwork, actually.
Yeah.
And for their intervention, they ask some fees. But
yeah,
normally,
it's,
no, it's not expensive. It's like the same question as with the cargo insurances. Eh? Normally, you should say, oh, an insurance, why all this cost to be added when there is nothing happening? But an insurance is very worthwhile, because it's about, as I said, only 0.30% for general carrier.
And which companies do this kind of transport insurance? Who are the leaders in the business of cargo insurance?
Pardon, you ask what kind of companies do the cargo insurance?
Do the insurance, yeah.
My experience says that every forwarder, they have very decent cargo insurance
included.
So again, entrust the cargo insurance business to your forwarder. They can help you in a very, very smoothly way. And if not, you can go, of course, to your own insurer. And for all the big insurance companies, they can provide cargo insurance policies. Eh?
Okay.
Like, don't for too much to mention. You have Allianz, you have.
All the big insurers, they're not, this is not a specific business for the big players are in this business. There was a question, who between the seller and the buyer chooses the Incoterm to be used in a sales
contract? That's a question about
who's the strongest.
Things that are preferable, and that is why I have shown the last few slides that I wanted to show. It depends on a number of factors. Eh? I've given you an example. When the buyer has a very good relationship with a shipping company, let's take again an example, a buyer in Montreal in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to buy goods from a Belgian company, and the buyer in Canada, they have a very good relationship with the shipping line, then they would prefer to buy FCA, because in that case, the buyer has a full control over the sea freight price and also about the transit time of the ship, for the simple fact that the buyer is booking the ocean freight. On the other hand, when the seller has a very good relationship with the carrier, then he could convince the buyer to say, Mr. Montreal, I can offer you CPT Montreal. So that means that the seller is booking the all the transport up to Montreal, and the advantage for the seller is then that he can mark up this price in his commercial invoice. That is legally allowed. He can take some benefits on the price that he agrees with the carrier. So you see, it depends on a lot of factors. For beginners, for very much starters, I should say that FCA is good. Because FCA, then, as I said, the buyer, he has control about the ship. Eh? You see?
Okay. This was the last word
for this seminar.
Okay.
Thank you, Eddie, for this very clear presentation regarding this quite technical aspect, which are very
okay.
important for the sales process and the export process. For having this process fluently done without no issue. Next time we will have it about the customs, and then we see you 2 weeks from now for a presentation about more general about the logistics. So
yeah,
Eddie,
okay.
Thank you.
So very good. Okay. So if the participants could compare this schedule with all my words, then it should be much more clear. Yeah?
Okay.
And okay, I thank you very much. And so you will add the remaining slides for the participants. Yeah. All right.
Yeah, we'll do so. We'll send the
okay.
The
thank you very much.
Thank you
you
very
very
much,
much
for you. And Eddie, thank you for you for all participants. And see you next time, next week.
All right.
Together with the BESI, the Chamber of Commerce, regarding the customs. Have a great
All right.
afternoon.
See you.
Okay, bye-bye.
Okay.
Bye-bye, Eddie. Bye-bye, everyone.
Bye.
Ciao.